to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Please be seated. Martin Luther King was a brilliant man who spoke with words, not his hands. He was one of the most important figures in the civil rights movement. His philosophy of cultural and social change through nonviolence was the dream he gave his life for. As you look around this auditorium today, you see people of all races joining as one. Please welcome Victor Maldonado in singing our national anthem.
His most famous book, A Lesson Before Dying, takes place in this quarter. The story is about two men, and they struggle to come to terms with their individual yet linked destinies. The main characters of the story are Jefferson, Nana, and Mr. Wiggins. Jefferson is a young, illiterate black man who unwittingly is involved in a liquor store robbery. Three of the people die. He's the only one left standing. Therefore, he is judged, prosecuted, tried as less than human, and sentenced to die in the electric chair. Mr. Wiggins, on the other hand, had left town before to attend the university. He comes back to do his so-called duty to teach the children of the parish. His decision to stay or go is one that he grapples with daily. Nana, his grandmother, Jefferson's grandmother, is one of the elders of the community, and she goes to Wiggins and asks him to go to Jefferson in jail and impart some of his learning, but mostly some of his pride, before the young man dies. In furtherance of this, Wiggins asks Jefferson to write in his diary. On the last day of his life, Jefferson wrote this. When I was a little boy, I was a water boy. I rode a cart, but now I got to be a man, sat in a chair. Don't know if you can read this, Mr. Wiggins. My hands shaking, I can hear my heart. I can hear Randy, but I ain't listening no more, because he's for the living, not for me. It's late, and I don't know what time it is, but I know it's late, because I just went to the toilet and washed my face. Day's breaking, sun coming up. A bird in a tree sounds like a bluebird. Sky blue, blue, Mr. Wiggum. Goodbye, Mr. Wiggum. Tell him I'm strong. Tell him I'm a man good. Bye, Mr. Wiggum. I'm going to ask Paul if he'll bring you this. Sincerely, Jefferson. Mr. Gaines traveled the college circuit for many years, and in one speech in particular, he said this to the college students. When I speak to black students about Hemingway, they often ask me what I expected to learn from that white man. I tell them all. All Hemingway wrote about was grace and depression. He was talking about you and me. Can you tell me a better example of race under pressure than our people for the past 300 years? Race under pressure isn't about bullfighters, it isn't about war. It's about getting up every day, face a boss you don't like, job you don't like. But you have to face it so you can feed the children so they can make a better generation. Thank you.
Good morning. Thank you. I will be reading Langston Hughes' God to Hungry Child. I will be God. He will be Hungry Child.
Hungry Child, I did not make this world for you. You didn't invest in my railroads. Where's your money in my corporation? Did you buy any shares of my stock? Did you? I made this world for the rich. You have been rich. You always will be rich. Not for you. I'm a child.
Thank you.
And I'm going to be reading a poem by Frau Gibson entitled Struggle. Born in a time of struggle, there is no safe haven for me, and possibly no other. Dreaming something unafforded, of no cost to another. No, I'm not indifferent than you and yours, simply attending to me and mine, giving hope that I too can live in this world that I have helped to build. Thank you. First, a sort of a tribute to all the great African Americans of time, and then I'll actually play a song from somebody that
has deeply influenced me.
Cedar Bell, James Sanquan, and I are going to read some parts of Dr. Martin Luther King's I Have a Dream speech. I am happy to join with you today in what will go down in history as the greatest demonstration for freedom in the history of our nation. 5 to 4 years ago, a great American whose symbolic shadow we stand today signed the Emancipation Proclamation. This momentous decree came as a great beacon light of hope to millions of Negro slaves who had been seared in the flames of withering injustice. It came as a joyous daybreak to end the long night of their captivity. But 100 years later, the Negro still is not free. 100 years later, the life of the Negro is still sadly crippled by the manacles of segregation and the chains of discrimination. We have also come to this hollow spot to remind America of the fierce urgency of now. This is no time to engage in the luxury of cooling off or to take the tranquilizing drug of gradualism. Now is the time to make real the promises of democracy. Now is the time to rise from the dark and desolate valley of segregation to the sunlight path of racial injustice. Now is the time to lift our nation from the quicksand of racial injustice to the solid rock of brotherhood. Now is the time to make justice a reality for all Black children.
We cannot walk alone, and as we walk, we must make the pledge that we shall always march ahead. We cannot turn back. There are those who are asking the dignity of civil rights, when will you be satisfied? We can never be satisfied as long as the Negro is the victim of unspeakable horrors, police brutality. We can never be satisfied as long as our bodies heavy with the fatigue of travel cannot gain lodging in the motels of the highways and the hotels of the city. We cannot be satisfied as long as the Negro in Mississippi cannot vote and the Negro in New York believes he has nothing for which to hope. No, no, we are not satisfied, we will not be satisfied until justice rolls down like water and righteousness like a mighty stream. I am not unmindful that some of you have come here out of great trials and tribulations. Some of you have come crushed from narrow jail cells. Some of you have come from areas where your quest for freedom must be battered by the storms of persecution and staggered by the winds of police brutality. You have been the veterans of creative suffering, continuing to work with the faith that unearned suffering is redemptive. Go back to Mississippi, go back to Alabama, go back to South Carolina, go back to Georgia. Go back to Louisiana, go back to the slums and ghettos of our northern cities, knowing that somehow the situation can and will be changed. Let us not wallow in the valley of despair. I say to you today, my friends, so even though we face the difficulties of today and tomorrow, I still have a dream. It is a dream deeply rooted in the American dream.
When we left for your brain, we will let it spring. When for the valley of Camden, from every state, every city, when we will be able to speak of the day of God's children, Black men, white men, Jews and Gentiles, Catholics, and we will be able to join hands and sing the words of the old spiritual Negro. Free at last, free at last. Oh, thank God Almighty, we're free at last. Thank you.
As we end our program, I wanted to tell you how this all came about. On behalf of the Office of Student Affairs, I emailed Ms. Spicer, I would say about 10 days ago, and asked her, what do you think about doing some kind of show in honor of Dr. Martin Luther King? And within minutes, she emailed me back, and she said, I'd love to do it. And within days, it was done. So on behalf of the Office of Student Life, I'd like to thank Ms. Spicer and the Office of And for those of you that know, this evening we are having our winter ball at the Ramada in Rochelle Park. And as part of that winter ball, we are giving out the Pinnacle Award and also leadership awards for each campus in New Jersey. I would say there's about 6 awards being given out from Bergen, but one of the students isn't able to be there this evening, so we'd like to present this person with the award at this moment. So I'm asking Ms. Remedios to come up.
Words came to my mind.
energy, enthusiasm, and persistence. And when I think of Martin Luther King, those three words apply. And when I think of the student who's winning this award now, those three words apply. This student has always shown that extra energy to do what has to get done, to do it right, to do it to the best of his or her ability. The student also has the enthusiasm. And enthusiasm to me is very key, whether you're in business or wherever in life. Because enthusiasm, if you're excited about what you're doing, you're going to get the support and the help from other people because you're just creating that enthusiasm. And the third key ingredient, persistence. Anybody who's been in my class, the accounting class, was terrible. 90% persistent, if you stick with it, eventually you get it. So I think persistence is another key in life and in leadership. And I would like to call the student up now to receive his award. Danny, come on.
Speech ready or anything. Oh my god. I'll thank my record producer and my
sing another song.
I would like to read the inscription on my plaque here. 1999 Middle Girls First Place Champion. That's me, ladies and gentlemen. A girl softball player. Anyway.
Now we have to explain the real trophy we get the other time. So we didn't want to embarrass
you. Nothing embarrassing. I don't know. This is a kind of a shock. Now I see what everybody wanted me to go to that thing. This is like kind of cool. I don't know. I just want to thank everybody. It's
you
pretty.
Deserve it.
We love thank you, Danny.
Thank you. This will be my last semester here, so I'm actually a little sad about that. Yeah. Mandatory booze, please. And but anyway, I really enjoyed my time here. I don't know. It has to do a lot with the students and of course the teachers because I took 7 years between semesters off, and so I made a decision this year to come back to school since 94, and I just came back a lot more energized than I was before, and anybody that kind of knows me, you know that I'm always there to help anybody out, and more than that, I'm just proud to be here, and thank you for this trophy.
First of many events that we can hold here in the auditorium. And as with any good show, we are now inviting you outside those back doors. There are refreshments.